Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you all here. It's good to know that you all reset your clocks last night. Will you join me, please, in the call to worship as it's printed in your bulletin? We give you thanks, O God, for you are good. Your steadfast love endures forever. When we cried to you with our troubles, O Lord, you saved us from our distress. We give you thanks, O God, for your wonderful works to all of humanity. Hear now our offerings of praise and thanksgiving as we tell of your deeds with songs of joy. Let us worship God. God of infinite goodness and mercy, we cannot escape your presence. Your promise remains with us in every situation. When we are desolate, your spirit comes to comfort us. Amid our tribulation, your chosen one remains our firm hope. We can sing your song in whatever land we find our abode. We shall forever give thanks for the gift of your grace. You are God who never forsakes us. To you be glory and praise now and forever. Shall we join together in our first hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, number 90. We join together in the prayer of confession. Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Know that God is rich in mercy. Even though we are dead through our trespasses, God's great love for us makes us alive through Jesus the Christ. We are thus saved by God's grace. Live in the assurance that as we confess our sin through Christ's intercession on our behalf, we are forgiven. As we greet each other, remember to greet those that are watching at home. The peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in peace.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello.
Hello. Candle's got to get her goodies.
Good morning.
Yep, got to get your goodies.
For sure. Does this gentleman have a school button?
Good morning, Pastor.
The bulletins are in all the pews. They're in all the pews. There's probably three of them on that chair. Here we go.
Within my heart, on melody.
have a couple of announcements about some of our young people in our church. I don't know if, Cameron, are you here today? Cameron yesterday or this weekend won her and her team on Future Cities competition. They won second place for designing a community on the moon. So congratulations to you. That's awesome. And I think we might have our diver up there. Do we have our diver here?
Yeah,
we do. We have two young women from our high school here. We have Olivia Martin and Olivia Lori. Both of them are members of our high school swimming and diving team, and you may not know yet, but they won the UP championships. So congratulations to those ladies. So a lot of great things happening in our community among our young people. So that's really exciting to get some good news and to reach out and congratulate them. They're amazing, these young people that can do so much with their time besides going to school and coming to church and being members of these sports teams and these activities. The other thing I wanted to remind you is we are in the midst of One Great Hour of Sharing. It's an opportunity during this Lenten season to join Presbyterians and Christians around the world in sharing God's love with our neighbors in need. And this includes our opportunity to reach out to those who have experienced natural disasters, those who are experiencing hunger, and it's an opportunity for us to support those who are oppressed and who are poor. So I remind you to give generously to that offering. I don't know, are there envelopes in your pews? If not, when you put an offering into the offering plate, mark them that it's a One Great Hour of Sharing offering. And for those of you who are watching us on the internet, you can go to presbyterianmission.org /giving to OGHS, and you can give online or contact the church, and they would be more than happy to assist you in giving through other means than coming into the church. Let us pray. Lord, we are so grateful in this time of the year that we can celebrate achievements of our young people, that we can be proud of the extra efforts they have given in their lives to improve our world and to improve themselves. Lord, we ask that you give us generous hearts and generous wallets that we give this time of year to One Great Hour of Sharing, as we recognize the need in our world is deep and wide. In your name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite people here for Sunday school to go to Sunday school.
First scripture text today comes from, Numbers, chapter 21, starting at verse 4. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in this wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among them, and they bit the people, so that the Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole. And whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. Our New Testament lesson today comes from Ephesians chapter 2, starting at verse 1. "You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passion of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated with him in the heavenly places, in Christ Jesus, so the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Jesus Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For what we are made is created in Jesus Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, starting at verse 14. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds are evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done by God. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The other day about the movies that Hollywood produces, and he was noting that except for like things like Marvel franchises, the superhero movies, and the Disney properties, he said there's probably about 10 movies that are made each year. And he said 9 of them are probably horror movies. And then one is that romantic comedy, a rom-com. I can remember when Hollywood started producing in mass the horror movies. And after watching a few of them, I thought to myself, well, surely this can't last. People are going to get tired of this. Of course, decades later, apparently, I was very wrong. One of the things all of these horror movies have is they have a couple of scenes in them where the main characters have finally realized that some evil is coming after them, whether it's vampires, whether it's zombies, whether it's some evil ghost or some demon is coming after them. And then there's this eerie scene where they hear a sound before the door, and one of them creeps quietly, slowly towards the door, reaches out, opens up the door, and suddenly has this startled reaction. And the person watching is left to wonder, did one of the evil monsters get them? And then, as the camera pans, you see they got startled by a dog or a cat that was simply sitting on the other side of the door. Or they'll be in a room and they'll hear a noise in the closet, and they'll creep towards the closet, and there's this eerie music, and they slowly reach out, gently open the closet, have the startled reaction. Something's coming out at them. Oh no, it's one of the monsters. No, it's just something falling off the shelf. Almost all of these horror movies have several scenes like this in them. Why? Because when people used to go to theaters, and now when they sit on the couch or in their chair at home, there's a lot of people who watch these shows who like them, and they love to have that startled response. And when the character on screen gets startled, they themselves get startled. Apparently, that is one of the appealing aspects of horror movies to people. I never really enjoyed them very much, and it always seemed pretty transparent to me when they were going to do the fake startle where it seemed like something was going to get the characters, but it was really just the cat or the dog or something falling off the shelf. But this week, I have to admit, I too went through a startled response. I was working, and as I was working, I was listening to the book of Isaiah. And boy, was God getting into it. I'm going to judge this nation, and I'm going to tear down this people, and I'm going to uproot this people. Boy, the judgments were flying everywhere. And as I was working, I needed to get something. So I got up, and just as I walked by my phone that was reading the book of Isaiah, someone called. So instead of hearing the reading, it started beeping at me, and I startled really quickly. I thought, oh my gosh, has God caught up with me? Has my sins, are they going to be visited on me? Am I going to be judged here? And the next second I realized, no, it's just somebody calling me on the phone. In our scripture text today from Numbers, God is visiting judgment upon a people, and it happens to be God's people. The people, as they were traveling through the wilderness, they began complaining against God and against Moses, and so God sent poisonous serpents among them and bit some of them, and some of them died. And so the people repented. They came to Moses, and they said, "We have sinned by speaking against you and against God. Pray to God for us." And so Moses, as he does, goes to God, and God tells him something interesting. He says, "Make a bronze serpent, put it on a pole, put it in the midst of the camp, and if anyone is bitten, if they go look at it, they will be healed. But if not, they will die. And so Moses does just that. He makes a bronze serpent, puts on a pole, plants it in the middle of the camp, and if anyone is bitten, they can go look and they can live. Now, it's at this point in the sermon I could normally move on. But we have someone in our men's Bible study group, and he is always sticking up for the common person. And he's always claiming that we're asking too much of the common person and their faith. And so I have to digress just a little bit to talk about why this was a just judgment in this case. These common individuals who are being punished this way by God, these are individuals who have seen God visit the 10 plagues on Egypt and to bring Egypt to its knees. So much so that the Egyptians not only wanted them to go, but gave them all sorts of treasures and riches to leave. These are the same people who saw God part the waters so they could walk through on dry ground and then use the waters to destroy Pharaoh's army, the pride of Egypt. These are the same people who witnessed God manifesting on the top of the mountain when the Ten Commandments were given, who heard the voice of God. These are the same people who watched God bring water from the rock through Moses, watched God through Moses bring birds so that they could have meat to eat when they complained about that, and then provided them with manna each and every day, which was all the nutritional requirements they needed. They didn't have to sow, they didn't have to reap, they didn't have to harvest. They just had to go out a few moments each morning and to gather some of this manna, and it would be enough for the entire day. They didn't even have to go to the supermarket and go through that. All they had to go out is for a few minutes and gather this manna, and they had all that they needed to eat. So yes, in this case, even though these common people, and sometimes we look back and ask a lot of them, in this case, this was a righteous judgment by God because they spoke against Moses and God. By this point, they should have trusted God, and by this point, they should have trusted Moses. Turning to our gospel lesson now, a Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus has come to speak to Jesus, and he's done so by night because he doesn't want his brother Pharisees knowing that he's speaking to Jesus. Now, he is vexed by Jesus, Nicodemus. On the one hand, he hears his Pharisaic brothers who say that it appears Jesus is not following the law and his apostles are not following the law. He hears them when they complain that Jesus might be bad for the people and lead them astray. And yet, on the other hand, when Nicodemus witnesses the miracles of Jesus, he knows that God must be with Nicodemus because no human being can do such miracles unless God is with him. And so he goes to talk to Jesus to get some clarity. And they have quite a discussion. And eventually, Jesus, in our gospel lesson today, refers to our scripture text from Numbers and says, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that all who believe in him may have life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him." So clearly, Jesus is using our scripture text today from Numbers to tell Nicodemus something very important. Something very important about the plan of God. And that's exactly what the Apostle Paul is talking about in our passage from Ephesians. He's talking about that sacrifice where Jesus was raised up on the cross, which John says exactly what Jesus was alluding to, his death on the cross. By that death on the cross, we have been set free. We have been cleansed. We have been washed clean. All of our sins have been put away by this act of Jesus, by dying on the cross and raising from the dead. Obviously, that's in a very important part of the plan that Jesus is trying to help Nicodemus understand. Jesus is standing before Nicodemus and he's telling them, "This is the plan of God for the sins of the world. I am the answer. My death and resurrection will put away the sins of the world." Clearly, that is one of the messages that Jesus is trying to get across to Nicodemus. But are there more messages? I think there are. And I think there are because Jesus specifically chose this passage of our scripture from Numbers to speak with Nicodemus about. And that's important because Nicodemus was a Pharisee, a very brilliant Pharisee. And so he not only would have known this story, he could have recited it to you verbatim without ever looking to the scrolls that were in the synagogue or the temple. And Nicodemus knew that our scripture today from the Old Testament, from Numbers, is not just about the forgiveness of the people's sins. It's about so much more. In our scripture text today from Numbers, not only is there forgiveness of the people's sins, but what they go through allows the presence of God to be with them, allows God to continue to lead them, allows God to continue to bless them as they are moving throughout the wilderness. It's not just the forgiveness of sins, it's also a restoration of this relationship where God can be present with them. And even more than that, by Moses putting that bronze serpent on the pole and placing it in the midst of the camp, he is putting the very power of God in the midst of the people. It was the power of God when they got bit by those snakes to go look at, and if they looked at it, they would be healed. I believe Jesus is saying so much more to Nicodemus than simply that I am God's plan for the forgiveness of sins. That would have been enough. That would have been amazing and incredible enough. But Jesus is also telling Nicodemus that I am God's plan so that God can be with people. I am God's plan so that God can bless people. I am God's plan so that they will never again be separated from God. And if all that wasn't enough, Jesus is telling Nicodemus through the use of this scripture text that Nicodemus would have known only too well. He's telling him, not only am I the plan for the salvation of sins, not only am I the plan for God's presence for everybody, but I am also the power of God in the presence of God's people. He was telling Nicodemus, the reason you know that I can work all of these miracles, the reason you're speaking to me is because you know the power and the presence of God is with me. In the same way that Moses took that bronze serpent, put it on a pole, and planted it in the midst of that camp so that it was the power of God in the midst of the people, Jesus came so that he could plant himself in our lives, in our minds, in our hearts, our bodies, in our souls, in our wills, in everything about us. He planted himself in there as the power of God. And just as those individuals in that camp who were bitten could go and look at that pole, anytime we wish to, anytime we want to, the power of God is in us in Jesus Christ, and we can go to him. Whatever the struggle is, whatever the difficulty is, whatever the pain is, whatever the suffering is, he is there in the midst of all of that with us. And all we need to do is go and look at the power of God that has been planted in our presence. Now, does that mean the suffering is going to go away? No, Jesus never promises that. Does that mean that if we go and look at Jesus that we're going to have the American dream or prosperity? No, Jesus never promised any of that. But what it does mean is if we do go to Jesus in those moments, we are going to the power of God that has the ability to raise us up in whatever situation we find ourselves. Jesus is telling Nicodemus, I not only came so that sins could be forgiven, I not only came so the presence of God could be with people, I not only came so that God could bless people, but I came to be with each individual in every one of their struggles, in every one of their trials, in every one of their pains, in every one of their difficulties. I am in the midst of my very people. And we have the same opportunity as those people in Numbers did so long ago. An opportunity that was given to us because Jesus has set us free. Because we are now sinless before God. Because he has given us the favor of God and the presence of God. We too have that ability anytime we want to come to Jesus because he is always with us. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for all the things that you came to give us. Things too great to even imagine. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Please join me in the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Any announcements? Oh, yes. Yes. Thank you. Anyone else? Any prayer requests? Okay, let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are so thankful to be able to come before you. We are thankful for the blessings that you have given us and the mercies. We thank you for breathing us into life, and when we had fallen and when we had become subject to sin, you came to save us. You came not only to save us, but befriend us. You came to be with us, and you came to lay out a path for each of us that leads to eternal and everlasting life, citizenship in the new kingdom, the new heaven, and the new earth. We thank you, Lord God, for all of these things, and we thank you for the gift and the promise of your Spirit, which is always with us. We pray, Lord God, that we will learn to open ourselves more, our minds, our hearts, our bodies, and our spirits, to the very Spirit of God in us, so that we can be led and so that we can live the example that Jesus gave us. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit, which we often frustrate, we often don't listen to, we often fight, we often drag our feet against, pray that your Spirit will continue to have patience in working with us, in molding us and shaping us, in creating us more and more into the image of what you created us to be. We thank you, Lord God, for all these things that you've given us. And we pray, Lord God, that your presence and Spirit will be with us as a people and with our country and our world. We pray, Lord God, that your work in our minds and our hearts to help us understand ways that we can help one another and support one another. Lord God, you gave us a community so that we would not be alone. And we pray that you'll enable each individual to find communities to help and support and to encourage them. We also pray this day, Lord God, we pray that your day will hasten. We pray that day will hasten when you will come and you will return and you will set up a world where there is only peace, where there is only justice, where there is plenty for all, and where there is no violence or bloodshed. We pray that this day will come, Lord Jesus. And now let's take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned with. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please join the prayer of dedication. O God of boundless love, you restore our strength through faith in your goodness. You look with favor upon us, and through Christ redeems us. You take from us, but promise your presence through the gift of your Spirit. You come from behind to push us, and go before us as our guide. Accept now what we bring you in response to your encompassing care of us. Amen.
He's got the wind and the rain.
grace and peace from him who was and is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen.